Hello there. Thank you for tuning in to another edition of the Vapor's Den. It's good to see you. My name is Aaron. I will be your host for a little while. We're just going to kind of dive into it. I'm going to omit the verbosity that I normally do in my normal videos, and we're just going to kind of jump right into it because today's conversation is an important topic, especially for things that could happen way down the road. I'm just planting a seed with this video. I'm just giving a little food for thought. I'm just stating that things could go a certain way, especially if the likes of big government via the FDA, local government, you know, state jurisdictions, and such have their way. And especially here in California, our state governor within the last couple weeks has signed into law making it available for FDA to regulate and restrict and tax vape gear, e-juice, mods, accessories, whatnot. Things like this now have been clumped in California as a tobacco product. There's nothing plantation about this. There's nothing tobacco leaf about this. There's nothing harvesting about this. There is nothing milled and refined at a tobacco refinery about this. This has nothing to do with the tobacco world, but the state of California now has made it easier for the FDA to swoop on in and do those dreaded, looming, threatening 2007 deeming statutes, to where our technology here in California has to roll back to 2007, because that's where the original deeming statutes were first organized, conceived, and written down, and agreed upon. Whatever idiot agreed to that. But today's conversation, in hence in the light of threat that the FDA is going to swoop on in and totally anti-revolutionize the vape industry, especially here in California, I wanted to talk and plant seeds, food for thought, and give you guys something to think about way down the road if and when the darkness falls. And what I'm talking about is conservation. One of these days it could be very important for us to conserve what little supply of almost everything we have. Yes, we can buy in bulk right now. I can go to Fast Tech, buy thousands of feet of Kenthal wire. I could buy hundreds and hundreds of organic pads. I can buy, you know, pennies on the dollar e-juice from unknown and known suppliers online. I could stock up, but even with the best of stocking up, and even with using it, you know, responsibly, conservation eventually is going to become a very important thing, because even the most well-stocked, war chest-stocked vapor is eventually going to face the fact that their once well-stocked supply is dwindling mighty thin, and conservation might need to come into play to extend the life of what you have, to extend your vaping experience, to extend the option of getting your nicotine and whatnots. So today's conversation is just about conservation. And what I have been doing these past couple days, and I'm about ready to show you how I built it in a very quick process that I like to call play-by-play. It's just going to be a series of slides. There's only three of them. Normally I do like 10 to 15 with some background music. Today we're not going to do that. I'm just going to show the slides, especially right now, to build the foundation for this conversation, to let you, the public, know what I'm talking about and what I've done. And so here we go. I'm just going to show you three slides. It'll take, you know, less than 30 seconds, and I will see you on the other side, as so that you know what I'm doing, and that way we can have a better conversation and you know where I'm going with things. So I'll see you on the other side of the play-by-play. Let's go. And we're on the other side. As you saw in those three simple slides with the, you know, I put, a little, documentation on the imagery to give you a feel of what's going on in the shot. As you saw, my Patriot V1, very rinky-dink basic, like first-gen RDA right now, is just being utilized with single coil and single wick construction. That's all. And I've run an experiment these past 3 to 4 days, actually 2 to 3 days, sorry. I have been running an experiment, kind of my own personal, in private, within the comforts of my own home. I have been running an experiment simulating what it might be like if my e-juice, my wire supply and wick supply, as far as organic Japanese cotton, was running dreadfully low. I have purposely gone out of my way to pretend that I only have 2 organic cotton pads left. I only have 6 to 8 to 10 inches of 26 gauge Kenthal wire, and I only have 1 15 mil bottle of juice left. What are you going to do? Well, I chose several days ago to utilize a little bit more of the wire to build a foundation for the simulation. I told myself I could just build a regular 26 gauge single strand, just, you know, rip around a micro screwdriver, build it that way, you know. But I thought to myself, sometimes when I'm re-wicking and cleaning an RDA built single strand, just 26 gauge, and I'm pulling the wick out, sometimes the coil moves, and sometimes it loses its consistency, it loses its tightness, and sometimes the move actually makes it obscured and really, you know, morphs the coil into something that can't, you know, be responsibly utilized, and you're getting max vapor, and so it really can kind of screw with it. So I said, you need a strong coil foundation, one that when you clean and re-wick with simulating you're dreadfully low on supply and you only got 2 cotton pads left, when you pull that through, it's got to be anchored. It can't move. So I told myself, well, first we're going to have to build a coil that can tolerate wick, re-wick, wick, re-wick, and etc. So I decided to utilize a little bit more wire from the get-go, therefore kind of cutting the longevity of the wire length, but utilizing it for a long-term build. And I decided to go 26 gauge, two little wires, twist them, and build my single coil that way. And then I just cut a small sliver of the organic cotton, slid it right on through, juiced it up, waited a minute or two, boom. Vape. Give you a little same thing we're talking about here, and the same thing you saw on the play-by-play is being utilized right now. So here we go. As you see, it's not too bad vapor production. I'm still getting the vapor. I'm still getting the same flavor as I would if I was burning 2 coils in here with 2 wicking systems. I'm still getting the same level of flavor. I'm getting good vapor production. I am getting longevity because I'm only using 1 coil versus 2. I'm also sparing the RDA of dual coil heat and wear and tear. I'm also only utilizing 1 wick, therefore stretching out my organic cotton supply. This video conversation in regards to conservation is the key. Conserving the wire, building strong anchoring builds, like twisted, clamped, and maybe no, nothing exotic like alien staple, all that. That's just needless porn, especially when conservation is key. You don't want to be utilizing all your supply to build like 8 inches of, you know, vape porn wire. You want simple, you want strong, you want longevity, and I would say maybe single strand, maybe 22 gauge, 20 gauge, if you're just going to just do a simple dual twisted at the minimum, if you're going to do twisted and clamped. And if you're going to do anything that's going to venture into the vape porn that could have good longevity, a Clampton might be the way to go. But for me, I'm a dual twisted guy. I'm a triple twist quad. If I got the wire and the power, I'm doing it. But today's conversation is longevity, conservation, utilizing smartly and responsibly what supply you have left. With me simulating that I'm dreadfully low these past couple days, it has impacted my normal daily vaping experience as far as I'm getting less vapor production, I'm getting less of a thick, consistent feel in both throat and lung and mouth. But again, I'm not really sacrificing flavor, and I know I'm getting the nicotine I need because there's still plenty of cloud being produced to deliver the nicotine within your lungs. But I'm normally a dual coil and a dual wick RDA guy. This single core construction, you can feel it. But I'd rather, with simulating dreadfully low supply, I would rather be lacking a little bit in vapor production and extending the life of my juice, extending the life of my wire, and extending the life of my RDA. Because eventually, if the state of California has its way, within years from now, a couple years from now, this will not be on the market to be purchased. And United States Customs will be advised about the California law, and it will make it law at both custom checkpoints in New York and Los Angeles and San Francisco, that if something out of country is coming in for a California state resident, like this, it is to be blocked. And I don't know quite yet if legal charges can be brought as far as trying to buy, you know, illegal gear or gear that cannot be sold within the state and you're trying to buy it other places. I don't quite know that yet. That information hasn't quite unveiled itself, but there is the looming threat of that as well. But again, conservation. Stretch your e-juice supply. Building thick, strong, long-lasting coils is going to extend your wire supply. Eventually, if you have to build single core, like the Patriot V1 is being utilized right now that way, it will extend the life of your organic cotton because you're only wicking one coil. So on that note, I think I'll start thinking about wrapping this up, vaping you on out of here. But again, conservation's the key. I'm only planting a seed here, a little food for thought. We don't have to really worry about conservation right now. Maybe building up a little supply might be in order. When you're at your brick and mortar, maybe buying a couple bottles that you, even if you don't want them, buy a couple bottles, get a little strong box, get a, you know, an old military ammunition box, a safe, a cardboard box, whatever. Start putting stuff in there just to build up your supply for that just in case down the road, especially if you are a California state resident like I am. And if the looming threats and the big scare of eventually these will not be available on the California market come true, you're going to want to have a good supply on hand. And again, I'm not trying to generate panic here. I'm not trying to generate sensationalism. I'm not trying to generate drama. I'm just using common sense that eventually we're going to think, all of us are going to have to think about our vape gear and our supplies. And we're going to have to do a mental projection, a mental forecast on how long those supplies would last in times of the feds dropping the ban hammer on a lot of gear, making it very hard for vape shops via the money that it's going to take to buy the permits, independent permits per independent mods, the bulk wealth of the expenditures and lawyers' fees, the possible vape shops going out of business due to these regulations, deeming statutes, and having to pay an exorbitant amount of money just to get a permit to sell one item, and each item requires a separate permit. Crazy talk. But we're just planting a seed today. Conservation. Well, that's my vape tip of the day. I don't have very much more to say about it, other than eventually we might all have to think about conserving what gear and juice and supply we have. This video is being generated for nothing more than planting a seed of thought, maybe giving you a trajectory on what to do, how to do it, and how to go about it. Again, when you're at your brick and mortars or online, you might want to start, especially if you're a California state resident, you might want to start beefing up your supply a little bit. I'm not saying, you know, build a vaping doomsday bunker and be a sensationalist as these doomsday preppers, but a little prep might be in order. But on that note, again, just conservation. Not bad, though. If push comes to shove, and one of these days even my supply runs dreadfully low, and I don't have the immediate availability of, say, going to a brick and mortar and buying, because buying is no longer an option, especially here in this state. If I had to live on just a single cork construction, a basic RDA, and a basic mod like an IPv4, I could live with it. Absolutely. I gotta get my nicotine somewhere. So you but have no choice, especially me, to say I could live with it. But on that note, I think I'm going to conclude this video. I hope you're having a good day or night, whenever it is you choose to tune in and watch. I'll try to produce some more vape tip videos as my brain gets enlightened with all of this and I have these ideas, and I think that it might be relevant and responsible to share. I'm still going to do my product reviews, but I'm going to start a new series of vape tip for the day videos. And this is session one. This is vape tip number one, conservation. On that note, it's been a pleasure. Again, I hope you all are doing good. Another video will be forthcoming down the line. And take them on easy. And I'm not trying to make sensationalism here, drama, or doomsday prepping. Just giving a little food for thought. It's something eventually all of us vapers, no matter how well we're supplied, might have to face. Might. Underline that with mental ready. Might. Have to face. We'll see how it goes. Take them on easy. Bye-bye.